And a good day. Welcome to Canada's Farm Show. Today we present the President's Panel. We talk with four prominent presidents of various organizations, including farming. And with me is Kyle Jaworski, the president of Viterra in Regina. We also have Don Henry from Seedmaster at Emerald Park. I have Jordan Cambites of Cambites Farms of LaJord, as well Dwayne Lingenfelter from Cypress View Land and Cattle Company in Shaunavon, Cypress Hills. Good day, gentlemen. It's good to see you all. And I guess let's start off with you, Kyle. Tell me, and I'll have each of you, tell me some of the things that make you proud of your company and give me a background as to what you do.
So good afternoon, and thank you for having me. Kyle Jaworski, I'm the president and CEO for Viterra North America. I've been with the company for 25 years. So I look after our Canada, US, and Mexican operations. There's a lot of things that I'm proud of. I'm proud of the history that we have. We've been successfully operating for 100 years. There's not a lot of companies that can say that. And I think what I'm most proud of is that we continue to evolve. We continue to focus on customer service. I think we're unique in the fact that we're in an industry that is always in demand. And I'm very proud of the fact that we continue to feed the world. We're exporting to in excess of 60 different countries, as well as have a strong domestic presence. So I'm really proud of the role that we serve and really the diversity that we've had and like I say, the history and the roots.
Thank you, Kyle. I want to ask Don Henry from Seedmaster the same thing. Don, explain your company and what makes you proud of it.
Yeah, sure, Jim. And like Kyle, thank you for having us today. So I'm relatively new at Seedmaster. I've been here just since August of last year. So can't take a lot of credit for what the company's done in the past. But I think most people in Western Canada will know that Seedmaster has been very innovative on the seeding equipment side, starting in 2002 and some roots, prior to that with the owner, Norbert Beaujeau. But probably their biggest claim to fame recently is the idea generation, the design and the implementation of the DOT tractor power platform, autonomous tractor platform, which for a small company to me was a tremendous accomplishment and got it to the stage that it was actually sold to a large US corporation. So I have to give them accolades for that, a tremendous accomplishment. But for today, what I'm really proud of is, once the DOT was behind us, that was a real distraction, I think, from the seeding equipment over the last 5 or 6 years. We're back to really focusing on seeding equipment. We've got a really good young group of engineers here at Seedmaster now. We've got some unique products out now, and we're going to have a lot more in the next couple of years. We've doubled our sales in the last year. We're looking for another big increase in our sales this year with a real renewed focus on our dealerships and our relationship with our dealers and with our customers. And so, we're just really fortunate to be in the ag business these days. Even in during a pandemic, the ag business has been outstanding. And so there's just lots of opportunities. And I think we're positioned very well to take advantage of them moving forward.
Thank you so much, Don. Thank you, Don. I want to ask Jordan Cambites of Cambites Farms at LaJord the same question. I understand you may be expanding. Tell me about the farm and your thoughts on the spring.
Thanks, Jim. Yeah, Jordan Cambites here from KF Cambites Farms out of LaJord, Saskatchewan. We're about 20 miles southeast of Regina here, and I'm currently the fifth generation running, managing, and operating the business. It's very much still a family-driven business. We've emerged and evolved over the last decade as a large-scale, vertically integrated operation, and I think really trying to supercharge our way into the new frontier of ag and create a platform that's not only sustainable, but an opportunity for the next generation to carry on. What I'm most proud of is the heritage, the legacy, and the longevity of my family roots and how we've been able to continue a sustainable operation and evolve and morph with the industry, adopting new principles and technology and methods. have really allowed us to stay on the forefront, remain competitive in what has been, you know, often a very tough industry. We're very excited. We're passionate and bullish in the agricultural space right now. Really looking forward to moving ahead here and creating continued opportunities for both our staff and our family.
Thank you so much, Jordan. Thank you, Jordan. I want to also then bring in Dwayne Lingenfelter, a rancher in southwestern Saskatchewan at Cypress View Land and Cattle Company in the Shaunavon Cypress Hills area. Dwayne, the same thing for you. Outline the farm, the ranch, and your thoughts on the year, the spring so far.
Well, thank you, Jim, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to join others on this great program, talking about agriculture, feeding a hungry world, and the role that Saskatchewan farmers and our suppliers play in this great industry. And let me just say, with the pandemic hopefully winding down in the next few months, I can tell you that it became obvious how important food in the supply chain was over the last 12, 18 months since the beginning of the pandemic, and the role that Saskatchewan and Canadian farmers play in supplying food around the world. Our family has farmed in the province since it was settled in the early period in 1910 and 1912. Both families immigrated from the United States, and my children are the fifth generation of farmers on our land. I'm very proud of the fact that my wife and I have five children, all of whom are on our advisory board and very involved in not the day-to-day operation, but the planning, the ongoing success. The biggest thing we've been able to accomplish in the last 10 years is diversifying the farm into eight different areas of the province of Saskatchewan, and have just reached out and started a venture near Billings, Montana, and are looking at other opportunities in that part of the world. We think by being diversified in different areas of the province and even outside the province, it reduces our risks and gives us an opportunity to take advantage of a very vibrant market that exists in North America.
Thank you, Dwayne. Now, I want to ask each of you a follow-up question. The follow-up question really has to do with the future of farming. What is the future of agriculture? And do you see agriculture as competitive, or is it cooperative? We'll start off with you, Kyle.
I think the answer is frankly both. I think when you look at the competitive natures of agriculture, there continues to be significant investment in our agricultural space. And that's local investment, that's global investment. So there's strong competition for the product, strong competition for that that end user as well. But we've got increasing global competition. We've got strong competitors that continue to evolve. You look at the likes of the Ukraine, of Russia, of Argentina, Brazil, very large producing countries that are making significant investments in their agriculture. And for us, then it shifts me to the collaboration. Is we need to and will continue to compete locally, but we need to collaborate on common issues. And you're seeing a lot more, in my view, collaboration on those common issues, on supply chain matters, transportation, regulation. We need to continue to collaborate to knock down barriers to ensure that our products are competitive on a global scale.
Good. Thank you, Kyle. Don Henry at Seedmaster. Don, what do you see as the future of farming? And what is it? Is it cooperative or is it competitive?
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting question, and I appreciate Kyle really focusing more on a global outlook there. I looked at it more from a, I guess, from a local standpoint, and I'll be interested to hear what Jordan has to say. And, you know, as farmers growing up on a farm, you know, we didn't share a lot of information. You know, we kept everything pretty close to our chest. And, you know, I'm not sure that that's the right way to be. Again, I would be interested in Jordan's observation, because what I found in my travels is some of the larger farmers now are collaborating more and talking about what they're doing on their farm and what are the best practices, and you know, maybe even sharing financial information, which in my history we just haven't seen. And yet, you know, a local dealership will belong to a focus group of maybe five or six other dealers, and they meet semi-annually and they share financial information and they develop objectives for the coming year, and they're each evaluated by their peer group and so on. And I just see, you know, some dealers will say that's the best 2 or 3 or 4 days they'll spend in the whole year from a strategic planning standpoint. And I think there's opportunities for our farmers to do that as well from a collaboration standpoint, although, you know, difficult to do locally. You know, neighbors are competing for land. Jordan will be competing for land on a regular basis, and difficult to do with local neighbors and so on. But I think there's an opportunity to expand that. And, you know, generally, agriculture, people, farmers, great people, let's get together. And I think there's a real opportunity to grow. You know, in Canada, Western Canada, we've done a great job of producing for so many years. And as I've traveled around the globe in the ag business, you know, Saskatchewan manufacturers, Saskatchewan farmers, Western Canadian farmers, extremely well respected around the globe when you get into Eastern Europe and so on. So I think there's an opportunity to do better. And I think collaboration is the key, and would like to see that moving forward. But I think there's tremendous opportunity in ag.
Thank you, Don. Now, Jordan, I want to ask you the same question. What's the future of farming, and do you see it as competitive or cooperative?
You know, following Kyle's point, I see it as both, Jim. You know, certainly we've seen a movement to a lot more collaboration here over the last decade. I would say we're seeing, you know, I think a large uptake in focus groups, lobby groups, different, you know, social media platforms. Information now is real time. It's on everyone's fingertips by the second, by the minute. And so I think it's really opened up the industry. It's opened up the world to what we're doing here in Saskatchewan and Western Canada prairies. But, you know, on the flip side of that is I really feel we're also facing a lot of headwinds in this space as well. And you know, environmental, social governance, foreign policy, investment, tariffs, and it seems like we're really fighting a lot of general misconceptions in ag. I think both at a local, you know, municipal and provincial level, and a real lack of direct education and knowledge, you know, surrounding the industry and the space. And I certainly see the collaborative approach helping that from a grassroots level and continue to show and help people understand that aren't part of the space that, you know, why this is the backbone of the prairies and Saskatchewan specifically. You know, we are by nature, we're in a competitive industry, you know, with our neighbors, other producers, suppliers, et cetera, but it's really for the betterment of our space to be collaborative and you know, I think continue to work on more domestic processing, more value add locally here, where we can continue to be less reliant on some of the foreign markets and different issues that we face logistically, being one of the landlocked territories in the world.
Thank you, Jordan. Now I want to ask the same question of Dwayne Lingenfelter, Cypress View Land and Cattle Company down in Shaunavon, Cypress Hills. Dwayne, tell me about the future of farming, and do you see it as competitive or cooperative?
Well, I think while farming has been the most important industry in the province of Saskatchewan, I think that is only going to grow as we go forward. And while I see farming as both competitive and collaborative, I think it's moving in the direction of being much more collaborative. And when I look around the world and we get an opportunity to travel in places like Poland and Russia, Colombia, Cuba, and look at the farming there and the advantages and disadvantages that Saskatchewan has, it becomes pretty obvious that while we're a long way from the market, and we don't have the most ideal climate, we have a supply chain of goods and services that are unbelievable. When I think of the services provided on fertilizer, chemicals, agronomy, needs from our John Deere dealer or Case, everything is at our fingertips. When I go to places like Colombia or Poland and watch the farmers there, it is very, very difficult to operate their farm compared to what we have in Saskatchewan and in Canada. And that's largely because of collaboration, working together, and finding solutions to the big problems we have, whether it's transportation or farming in general. So while I think it's both, I think I would lean towards the idea that it's much more collaborative.
Thank you, Duane. I appreciate that very much. Now, the next question really has to do with leadership. What makes you a successful leader? All four of you run big, successful companies. What makes a successful leader, and what are some of the qualities that you bring to the table for running such big companies? Because farming is not small potatoes anymore. Farming is big business. We'll start off with Kyle. Kyle?
Well, really, throughout my career, one of the most important skills that I've cultivated has been the ability to manage change. I really believe this is a fundamental skill for success in today's world. How successful people can handle the constant flow and change and their willingness to embrace it, I think, is very important. In my experience, I've found that learning to deal with difficult challenges, difficult changes, allows you really to grow as an individual. So really, constant change is part of every successful career. I also believe in accountability. I learned really early in my career that accountability and accepting responsibility for the business outcomes, whether they're positive or negative, is really important. It's a key leadership trait that really drives results. It's also about asking yourself whether you've done everything you can to achieve the desired results. This means challenging yourself, challenging your colleagues to always strive to do better. I also think as a leader, you need to have vision. People, you know, need direction. They want direction. With that, a clear direction, a clear vision. We need to show the destination. We need to help them sometimes with the path to get there. Sometimes we need to let them find their own path. This really instills a sense of purpose. I think that anyone who aspires to a leadership role in business needs to have the ability to plan and execute.
Well, I want to ask Don Henry of Seedmaster the same question. What makes a successful leader? What makes you a successful leader?
Yeah, thanks, Jim. A little bit of time to think about it. You know, I think for me, number one is honesty and integrity. You know, and if you don't do what you say you're going to do, then you're really done before you start. And so that's always been a huge core value for me over the years. I think secondly, for me, it's about team building. I come from a bit of a sports background, and really that got ingrained in me early in my life, and I've carried that through all the organizations that I've worked with, and every person in your organization is important. If they're not playing a role, then you probably shouldn't have them in your organization. So generally the organizations I've worked with, we've really tried to keep the hierarchy very flat, and that it doesn't matter if you're the CEO or the president or a welder, we'll do whatever it takes to get the job done. And maybe I'm fortunate because it's a relatively small company and we're able to do that, or I've been dealing with relatively small companies and you're able to do that. But that's always worked very well for me. And I really hold by that. I think as I've gotten older, I've realized the importance of communication. And I would say that earlier in my career, I wouldn't say that I was the best at it. And I find now how critical that is. And maybe that's related to some of our later questions. And and you know, the workforce that we're dealing with and so on. But I just find that now it's so important to have good communication skills and, you know, be constantly updating your staff and letting them know where you are and what you're doing and what the direction is. And I think that leads into what Kyle said. And I think I agree with him that you have to have vision. You have to have vision of where the organization's going, and you have to communicate that to your staff, and so that they have that opportunity to buy in and move with you in that vision as well. So those are probably the key items that I see from a leadership standpoint, Jim.
Thank you, Don. Now, on the farm, labor is key. It's critical, and it's very hard to find someone who can do everything, be a mechanic, run equipment, and basically know what they're doing. So I want to ask Jordan, Cambites, Jordan, running a big farm, there's a lot of labor involved. What makes you a successful leader? What are the attributes that are needed to run a successful farm?
You know, Jim, for us, it's all about culture. The team environment, we're at a scale now where we're able to offer career year-round positions. The days of having, you know, the jack of all trades are starting to fade into the rearview mirror. And really, you know, we view ourselves as a big chain, and we have a lot of individuals with specific skill sets that, you know, in conjunction with other people that have other specific skill sets, you know, creates a real strong, unique foundation for us to be successful and for our team to really rely on each other. And with that culture, we've created a dynamic that I think is impervious to any one person, you know, going down. We have a real level playing field. You know, one of the other major qualities that I look at as well is resilience. You know, I think great leaders need the ability to bounce back in this sector. It's a real up and down industry. We're reliant on the weather and markets and you know, geopolitical risk and things like that. So we need the ability to bounce back intellectually, physically, emotionally. These are all related to being resilient in the industry. A clear vision, sharing that vision with your team, having them buy into that vision. And within that vision, I think, you know, the eternal optimism of a farmer. That's one thing that generation after generation never goes away. It's the optimism. You know, it's going to rain next year. It's going to rain next week. There is going to be a better day. So, you know, those are some of the qualities that we really lean on and rely on. And you know, in addition to that, some of the ones that stick out to me are courageous. You know, the days of going into the battle at seeding or spring or harvest time, you know, it takes a lot of courage. And, you know, I think I admire our team when we go into battle together and we come up with a lot of different innovative ideas. We've created a platform that allows for open communication to bring ideas forward. And it all revolves and stems back to creating a very vibrant and dynamic culture.
Thank you, Jordan. Now, Dwayne, I want to ask you, Dwayne Lingenfelder at Cypress View Farms in Southwest Corner near Shaunavon, Cypress Hills. What makes you a good leader? What are the leadership attributes you bring to the table to help keep things going?
Well, I agree with Kyle that building a team is really what success in a company or an organization is all about. But in order to get there, I think the biggest thing a team leader can do is exude passion, love, and excitement for the job at hand. And whether that's farming or building machinery or running a machinery company, really the leader has to be there giving that passion and teaching every day on the spot of why the work we're doing is so important. The other thing I find that is a detriment in a company is when you spend too much time either celebrating your successes or looking back and analyzing your mistakes too long. It's true, you have to do both. You should celebrate your success and you should analyze where you went wrong, But if you dwell too long on those topics, you're not paying enough attention to what's coming at you over the horizon. And what I find makes successful leaders are those who can anticipate and assume and predict what the next big challenge is going to be and prepare yourself for that event. And right now, if you're saying, well, what is the next big event in agriculture? It's really dealing with technology, the regenerative farming idea of how do we change from using so much chemical and so much fertilizer to how do we take care of the soil, the microbes in the soil, and do it in a more natural way that will meet the needs of the environment. And I don't see that as a difficult issue. I see it as a challenge and really what will make the next stage of agriculture even more exciting than the one today. So I find passion to be one of the biggest and most important things that a leader can exude to his staff and to the team.
Passion and interest will always win in leadership. That's a great idea, a great suggestion. I guess the next question that I would have is, how do you motivate your people to come up with new ideas, to think outside the box, be creative? And what's the upcoming workforce going to be? And we're quickly running out of time, so keep it to about a minute if you could. Gentlemen, start off with you again, Kyle, please.
So, you know, how do you motivate your people? I think number one is we're constantly looking at recruiting the people that have the passion and the drive to excel and to grow. We need to ensure that we keep a culture of openness, of collaboration. We constantly encourage our staff by design to communicate regularly with managers, with others. We're always looking for best practices and sharing that across the organization, both locally and globally. And I think that's important that we have that good open communication. You know, what will the workforce look like? I think that we need to continue to attract people into our industry. And I think that it's an industry that we need to keep telling the story. It's dynamic. It's a rewarding place to work. You know, we've been working with a lot of industry partners on positive messaging, the importance of agriculture here at home and globally. You know, we do help farmers feed the world. We need to make this message more prominent. We talk about the economic, the social contributions to society. I think all these things resonate with the new generation. It fits well with these employees, you know, need to work for really purpose-driven organizations. I don't think we're only looking for people with agricultural backgrounds. We're looking for diversity. And I think, you know, when you look at an organization like ours, we need people with agricultural backgrounds, but we also need people, you know, in finance roles and in IT roles and HR and in trading roles. And I think that that's often misunderstood. I think that there are tremendous opportunities in our industry. And I think we are telling the story, but I think we can continue to do more to just tell how dynamic and how important of a role we do play.
Thank you, Kyle. Now I want to ask Don Henry the same question. Don, how do you motivate and what's the future in the workforce?
Yeah, so from a motivation standpoint, Jim, again, I think everybody's talked a little bit about culture and how important that is and enjoying coming to work. And I'd like to say that, you know, if you don't enjoy coming to work, you know, the great thing about living in North America, you can probably go do something else. And it's probably good for you as an individual and good for the company as well if it's not working for you. So I totally buy into the passion and culture side of it. From an idea generation standpoint, you know, with Seedmaster being in the seeding business, and as you know, when you look around Saskatchewan and you see the other seeding manufacturers, we have some really good competitors and we have to be motivated and we have to be driven to continue to come up with new ideas. You know, if we have staff that aren't doing that, we probably need to change the staff, as harsh as that sounds. But really to make that happen is they need to understand our industry. We do a lot of collaboration. And I know that's a word that keeps coming up, but We involve a lot of people in our decisions. At the end of the day, the buck stops at my desk, but I'm always looking for input from all of our staff to come up with creative ideas to help Seedmaster grow and expand. In regards to the workforce, I would agree with Kyle that we need a diversity of different people, certainly in our administrative roles and so on. I don't think having an agriculture background is critical, although I think they'll feel the passion in our organization. I would say from a public-facing standpoint, we probably need to have agriculture backgrounds for those individuals. Just over the years, I found that certainly from a customer, from a dealership standpoint, when we're public facing, we need to walk the walk and talk the talk, and maybe that sounds too focused, but I think that's reality. As the millennials start to be a big percentage of the workforce, my kids are millennials, so I kind of know where they're coming from. My son had an opportunity to work for a U.S. consulting firm, and their project supervisors would meet with them every 3 weeks, and they would have formal evaluations, every 6 months. And I know from my own standpoint, from a communication, from an evaluation standpoint, over the years, that's been lacking. That, we do an annual evaluation because we had to, probably didn't do a very good job of it. And I think that's got to change with our workforce. We need to communicate more with our workforce so that they understand our vision, understand how they fit into our organization, understand how they can grow and be successful with our company in a role that they're happy with and living a lifestyle and providing them with enough financial resources to live the lifestyle they want to lead. So I think that's a key for us moving forward is doing a much better job of communicating with our staff.
Thank you, Don. Jordan Cambites at LaGeorge. Jordan, how do you keep your team motivated on the farm? And what's the future of the workforce?
Yeah, thanks, Jim. To keep our team motivated, it's all about empowerment in our operation. We've empowered every individual, regardless of their knowledge or skill set in ag, to come forth with new ideas, best practices, SOPs. And it's really created a dynamic where the individuals are challenging each other, they're collaborating. Another way, that we've been finding success as well in motivating the team is doing a lot of collaborative approaches, workshops with other neighboring operations, other people within the sector that maybe aren't primary producers, but are equipment manufacturers or, chemistry providers and so on and so forth. So, that's a big driver for us. I think for us, what we're seeing is, it's a common theme with a lot of people on the show today is the diversity of the workforce. We're bringing talent in from all over Canada, even some individuals overseas. But what's really rising to the top is good people. We've emerged and evolved to really trying to source out good, smart, passionate, driven individuals, and we will take the time and train them both informally and formally with the processes and methods that we want that fit our organization and fit our sector. And where there's formal training available, some of the undergraduate and graduate programs are coming along, some of the trade schools, we're finding evening workshops, so on and so forth. They're providing value to these individuals, which in turn are providing value to us. We're seeing an emergence, in the technology in this industry, both from an ag science standpoint, but also from an ag tech and ag manufacturing. So that's bringing forward a new level of skill set where they may not have direct ag skill, but are very proficient in technology and the IT side. And I really see that playing a large and emerging role in our space.
Thank you, Jordan. Now, I also want to ask Dwayne Lingenfelter from Cypress View Land and Cattle Company. Dwayne, how do you keep your team motivated? And what is the future in the workforce, of the workforce?
Well, I think motivating the team is obviously the responsibility of the leader. But when you cut to the core, I think agriculture needs to quickly and is obviously moving to proper pay, social programs, whether it's dental care, all of the programs that they might be able to get in another industry. I think agriculture has been lacking in that area. And with the growth of the size of farms, I think we can't expect to have labor law and other privileges within the farming organization that other industries don't. So I think the bottom line will be salary and the programs that we have to offer to compete with other industries, whether it's automotive or manufacturing. The farm community is going to have to match that. Having said that, I think the new generation of workers, and some people despair, and I hear many times on Coffee Roll how it ain't like it used to be when it comes to hiring. I find the exact opposite. If you have a good HR team that is looking for and screening and chasing down the right recipients, you can find the best employees that ever existed in today's economy. Having said that, I think it's important that we have immigration laws that open up, that allow us to seek the best in the world at any time without a lot of restrictions. And that means people moving both ways, that if some job comes up in the United States that my son or daughter is better suited for, they should move with some ease. And the reverse, if I need somebody from India or Colombia or Russia, many of our employees with my contractors are now from foreign countries, and I think that's a good thing. And the movement of the workforce and the mobility of the workforce, I think, is one of the things that will really come into vogue in the coming years in agriculture.
Thank you, Duane. And I want to thank all my panelists on this President's Panel for Canada's Farm Show. And we had today Kyle Jaworski of Viterra in Regina, Don Henry of Seedmaster at Emerald Park, Jordan Kambites of Kambites Farms at La Jorde, and Duane Lingenfelter from Cypress View Land and Cattle Company at Shaunavon Cypress Hills. I'm Jim Smalley. Thank you for watching.
Grain headquarters? That's Regina, home of Viterra, who partners with farmers across Canada and America and Mexico to market and move their crops to customers in 60 countries. We're headquarters for your breakfast, lunch, and dinner. From Regina, we feed the world. We are growing the impossible.